dog, buy me a house. What do you give someone who has everything? It's a question that I ask myself often when I think about God. The Bible says that the cattle on 1,000 hills belong to Him. He owns everything. He created us in His image and His likeness. And so what do you give someone like that, that owns everything? Would you sell your home for Him? Would you go to bat for Him? What would you give someone who has everything? You know, sometimes as Christians, when we begin to think about the concept of giving, we get a little weary. We think that we're doing God a favor when we are encouraged to give. But the interesting thing about God, who is our King, who has everything, is that He gave everything for you and I. He didn't withhold His best. He gave His best. John chapter 3 and verse 16 says, "For God so loved the world." Let's meditate on that. He so loved the world. The love God has for us, the Bible says, is from everlasting to everlasting. Apostle Paul even says that nothing can separate us from the love of God. His love is never, the Bible says, never fails. And as a result of that love, He said in John chapter 3 and verse 16, that He gave His best. He gave His all so that you and I will not perish but have eternal life. God deserves our best. Say amen to that. Amen. God deserves our best. You know, Colin made a statement just now. He said, God is your resource. But you see something? God is not just our resource, but He's also our source. Hallelujah. He's someone, He's a person you can go to pull resources from when you are dry. But He's also the person that is the reason why you are alive. For you to even walk to Him and pull the resources is as a result of the life that He has given to you. So He's not just our resource, He's our source. Hallelujah. He's our source. He's the reason why we are alive. He's the reason for the season. He's the reason for our promotions. He's the reason for our advancement. He's the reason for our protection. He's the reason for our provision. The fact that you are not completely annihilated, the fact that you're not completely destroyed, the fact that you have not completely been wiped out, is because of God. It is because of God. So coming back to the question I asked, what do you give someone who has everything and who has given his best to you and I? The least we can do is offer Him some thanks. The least we can do is to honor Him. The Bible says that when you honor God, God will honor you. The Bible also says that we should honor God with our substance, with our hearts. It's not just enough to say, Lord, I thank you. Lord, you've been good with your mouth, but you have to show it with some action. You have to prove it. Jesus said, if someone were to come to you and ask you for some food, and you said, oh, brother, it's well with you, and do not give him the food, He said, you have wasted your time. You have not shown Him love at all in that sense. It is not enough for us to give God lip service. We must put some actions to the words that we proclaim towards Him. I meditate about God's goodness towards me every time. And I realize that God is not in need of my money. God is not in need of any gift. But what God needs most is my connection with Him. And as a sign of respect to Him, anytime I come to Him, I just like to come with a gift to say thank you for loving me first. Thank you for giving me your best. Thank you for not withholding salvation from me. And so as we prepare to give our offering this morning, I want us to meditate on God's goodness, meditate on his love, meditate on his power and his presence and his protection that he has wrought to us. Hallelujah. Let's prepare our tithes and offerings. I'm sure you have your envelopes with you. If you are writing out a check, please make it out to the City Light International Church. Just a couple of additional announcements before we pray over the offering. As you can see, the children are with us this morning, and that's because we are doing some construction in the church. The entire downstairs, the plumbers are relaying pipes downstairs. If you go downstairs to the restrooms, you'll see that the grounds have been dug up. We were hoping to finish that before Sunday, but we did not. So we're going to continue this week, and hopefully by the end of this week, the entire pipe downstairs will be done. You see, we're having a lot of flooding, so we had to dig up the whole grounds and lay new pipes downstairs. So that's something that's going on. We're going to be working on the stage, and we're going to be creating the green room this afternoon. Please plug yourself into what God is doing. You know what I said? God has been so good to us. Whatever you do right now, don't see it as if you're doing it unto a man or a person or a church. Let your service be unto what the Lord. Let your offering be unto the Lord. I don't have money. I don't have anything. You have some strength. You have some energy. You have some time. Give God your best. City Light, give God what? Your best. So plug yourself in with what God is doing. Don't wait for an announcement to be made for you to come up. Step forward. This is your house. Hallelujah. We are all children of God. Children of God. So this is your home. Ask, how can I participate? Lord, what can I do to walk in your kingdom? And he will bless you. Did you get something from that? Yeah. Amen. Just lift up your offerings as we pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we give you praise and thanks. Thank you so much, Lord, for giving us your best. Thank you for Jesus, whom you sent to liberate us from sin. And so, Lord, we come this morning as a family to honor you with our offerings. We honor you with our tithes. We honor you with this gift as a sign of respect and reverence to you. Thank you, Lord, for all you've done. And we pray your blessing upon us as we give today. May it be given back to us, good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over. Men shall give to our bosom for your glory, O God, and for your honor. And Lord, we thank you because these gifts and offerings will be used for the expansion of your kingdom to your glory and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want you to give it cheerfully because God says he loves a cheerful giver. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen.
They said many are called, a few were chosen, but I wish some wasn't chosen for the blood spilling of Rwanda. They said me shocky, shocking, I've been there go, thrown in the fire, but you never get burned. But I wish some didn't get burned in Rwanda. They said the man is judged according to his works. So tell me, Africa, what's your worth? There's no money, no diamonds, no fortunes on this planet that can replace Rwanda. Rwanda, Rwanda. These are the cries of the children. Anybody hear my cry for America? It's the United States of America. Then why can't Africa be the United States of Africa? Rwanda, Rwanda. And if England is the United Kingdom, then why can't Africa unite all the kingdoms and become the United Kingdom of Africa? Rwanda, Rwanda. Rwanda, Rwanda. Yeah. Can anybody out there hear our cries? Yeah. Heaven's cry. Jesus cry. Yeah. Lord, can you hear us calling you?
Transformation of nations, raising saviors to influence the seven spheres of society with the principles and the character of Christ. When we talk about the vision, we're talking about people who want to go beyond the norm. These are people who see themselves as the salt of the earth, the light of the world. These are agents of change, planet shakers, world changers, history makers. And they're trained to enter into the seven spheres to displace the value systems of this world and to replace it with the value systems of Christ. Every nation on the planet is established upon seven major structures. You have the government, you have business, you have education, you have arts, entertainment, and sports, you have the mass media, you have religion, and you have the family. And in order to transform a nation, you'll have to transform these seven structures. How do you do it? By raising people, the people of God, to enter into these seven structures and displace the value systems of this world and replace them with the value systems of Christ. And that's what transformation of nations is all about. It's connected to the great commission that Jesus gave to all of us, the discipleship of nations.
So praise God. So the video we've just watched is of Pastor Sino Agwezi. And I'm very excited to announce that Pastor Sino will be with us during the week of the anniversary. Praise God. Can somebody say Transformation Chicago? Say that again, Transformation Chicago. Awesome. Pastor Sino has a heart for missions, and he has made himself available during the week of our anniversary to be here. So for everybody right now in your calendars, whether on your phone, on your iPad, in your notebook, wherever you sort of manage your personal calendar, we need you to clear out from Sunday, November 3rd until Sunday, November 10th. It's a full week, and our mission is what? Transformation Chicago. One more time. Transformation Chicago. Also, in preparation, Pastor Sino has sent this book, and Pastor Lan has been able to get us access to it. There's a copy of this book called Inquire, The 7 Questions of Life, available for everyone at the back right after the service. So make sure you don't leave the service without a copy of this book. It's Pastor Sino's book, and it's available for free. There's no charge. So get a hold of this book. Start reading it in preparation for the anniversary. If you're excited, can I just see you wave? I'm looking forward to it. Watching that video just got me so excited. So clear out your schedule from November 3rd, Sunday, November 3rd, until Sunday, November 10th. We are continuing to look for volunteers. Is there anybody in the church today who is not plugged into a team? Okay. If you're not a part of a team, if you're not part of a volunteer team in preparation for the anniversary, please see me right after the service. We don't want anybody to miss out on this amazing week. We want everybody to be a part of what God is doing in our city through us. Finally, we want to ask all of you for your nominations for our GLOW Awards. GLOW stands for Great Leader, Outstanding Witness. Our past recipients of this award have gone on to literally change the world. So if you know anyone in your circle of influence that you believe is doing great things and impacting the lives of people, please give their information to Lani. Lani, would you please wave your hand so everyone knows who you are? Please forward your nomination to Lani, and we'll make sure that they're considered for the GLOW Award. So thank you again, and we're looking forward to seeing you all on the week from Sunday, November 3rd until November 10th for our anniversary. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. How has it been so far? Hasn't it been a wonderful service? Amen. So every Sunday, we're going to be showing clips of the ministers, the people that will be speaking during the GLOW conference and its anniversary. I want to correct that for those of you making announcement. The CityLight GLOW Conference and 8th anniversary. The anniversary is just on Sunday. Do you get that? But the GLOW Conference is throughout the week. GLOW for the conference stands for Go Light Our World. Amen. And we're going to be having people from different parts of this nation, even part of the world, that will be speaking on that week, amen. So we're going to be showing the clips so that you can get familiar. I'm very familiar with them. Pastor Sino is my very, very good friend. And, other people coming up. Pastor K is going to be coming, amen. Pastor Bose Adelaja, all the way from Ukraine, is going to be around. Pastor Dala Alfonso, all the way from Omaha, will be around. Pastor Sam Oye, all the way from Nigeria, will be around. Pastor Louis Reyes is going to be around, all the way from Zion, Illinois, and more and more and more people. Dr. John Fielder from Moody Bible Institute will be around. Amen. So it's going to be an awesome night. We have made sure that every day there is a specific stream, there's a specific focus. God operates by calling people and sending them to do different things. And there are some important streams that every believer must be exposed to. So on Sunday, we have the supernatural stream. Everybody say supernatural stream. So we're having a Sunday night meeting called Supernatural Night of Wonders by Pastor Kayode Ijishesa. And then on Monday, we're having what we call the compassion and justice stream. So on Monday evening, we're going to have Dr. Fielder speaking to us and ministering on how to be an agent of compassion and justice in the world. Amen. On Tuesday, we're going to be having what we call the Maximizing Your Life stream. And we're going to be having Pastor Sam Oye speaking to us on that very topic. How do you maximize your life, fulfill the vision of God for your life? It's a night of purpose. And then on Wednesday, we're going to be having the relationship stream. Everybody say relationship stream. 1+1. We're going to be dealing with the issue of relationship, marriage, singles, and all that. On Thursday, we're going to be having the financial empowerment stream. And we're going to be having Pastor Dala Alfonso all the way from Omaha speaking to us on how to maximize your career, your business, and how to be, how to maximize your financial life. Amen. And then on Friday, we're going to be having what is called, what we call the Breakthrough and Revival Night. Everybody say Breakthrough and Revival Night. And we're going to have Pastor Louis here. Amen. Reyes. It's going to be a powerful night. On Saturday morning, we're going to have the Glow Awards. Great witness and outstanding, great leaders and outstanding witness. Your nominations are needed. The nominations should be in before the end of this week. Please send the email to Olani, and then the committee will make the choice of the people that will be receiving the award. And then on Saturday evening, we have Flavors. Everybody say Flavors. And that is the diversity stream, Flavors. So it's going to be a night of diversity in music, diversity in nationality, ethnicity. We're going to have flags of nations. We're going to dress, you know, you can come in any attire of any nation that, you know, you want, but don't come in the attire of your nation. Amen. I think I'm going to be an Indian on that day. Amen. With my, what do you call it? An American Indian. So it's going to be a powerful time. And we're going to have Pastor Sino, who will minister. We're going to have music of all kinds. We're going to have food from different nations. And we're going to celebrate God's diversity in his kingdom. Amen. And then on Sunday afternoon, everybody say Sunday afternoon, we're going to have the grand finale, which is the celebration of the 8th anniversary of City Light Church, Chicago, the launch of our vision 2014, amen, and the consecration, the prayer for us for 2014. And we're going to have my spiritual mother, amen. We're going to have Pastor Bose Adelaja. She's going to be here to do that with all the other ministers. It's going to be a powerful time. Amen. Hallelujah. How many of you are ready for it? Are you getting ready? Like I told you, get prepared. Start praying. Start inviting people. Start clearing your schedule. The calendar has been given since the beginning of the year for this anniversary. And for subsequent years, it is always the first week of November. Our anniversary is always what? The Glow Conference and anniversary is always what? The first week of every November from this time until Jesus comes. Amen. Except God says something else. So I want you to clear your calendar for every year for that. Also important, next Sunday. Everybody say next Sunday.
Next Sunday.
Next Sunday is our City Connection Sunday. Everybody say City Connection Sunday. Which means that we're just going to have 30 to 40 minutes of service here in the church. And we're going to disperse to different parts of the city and the community to minister to people, to serve people. Information on the groups, you know, the places we're going to be going will be coming to you by email. So if we don't have your email, please fill it in the connection card. Information will be coming throughout the week. And on Sunday, we'll meet and then we'll disperse to all those places to minister to the community. And also invite them for the Neighbor Sunday that is coming up the Sunday after. Amen. So that is the announcement. Let's look into God's Word. Are you ready for God's Word?
Yes.
So for the next 35 minutes, I want all your focus to be on God's Word. Are we ready? If you're ready for God's Word, say, I am ready.
I'm ready.
Say, I am ready.
I'm ready
for the Word of God. And I'm going to be speaking, continuing my message on the kingdom culture. The kingdom culture. Everybody say the kingdom culture. The kingdom culture. We have defined culture as the total range of activities, the ideas of a group of people with shared traditions. We also defined it as the beliefs, the values, the attitudes of a collective group of people. So when we're talking about kingdom culture, we're talking about the thinking, the attitudes, the beliefs, and the values that God wants us to imbibe, that is part of his own country, his own kingdom. Amen. Hallelujah. Everybody say kingdom culture. Kingdom culture. It's important. It's important. Now, I've said a lot, so if you want to know more about what I've said before, the messages are available on the website. You can go and listen to them. But I'll try to go back a little bit. So we defined culture. And we said that we, as kingdom people, we have been transferred from the kingdom of darkness. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 12. We have been transferred from the kingdom of darkness, and we've been transferred into the kingdom of God. So, verse 13. We've been transferred from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God. He delivered us from the power or dominion of darkness, and he has conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of his love. So when you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you experienced a transfer. You experienced a change, a position. So we are now in the kingdom of God. Everybody say, we are now in the kingdom of God. So when you transfer kingdoms, you also need to transfer attitudes. You need to transfer culture. Is that right, everyone? If you move from the United States to the United Kingdom, you have to change some things about the way you behave. One of the most glaring ones is that you have to change how you drive, because you drive on another side of the road. Amen. So the same way, when you got transferred into the kingdom of God, you need to change. Because what we were used to before we got into the kingdom of God, we were used to operating like the world. We're used to operating with the world's system. Amen. Hallelujah. So let me tell you, I want to show you, just some characteristics of the kingdom, the values of the kingdom, or the culture of the kingdom. The first very important one, it is totally the opposite of the kingdom of the world. It's the total opposite of what? Of the world system. That's why we say the kingdom is countercultural. Everybody say the kingdom is countercultural. That's why when you're operating by kingdom principles and kingdom values, anyone who is operating by the kingdom and the system of this world will see you as strange, because it's countercultural. That's why there's a clash of culture, because it's an upside down kingdom. Everybody say it's an upside down kingdom. When you say upside down kingdom, you're saying that if the world is like this, the kingdom of God is the other way. If the world is like this, the kingdom of God is the other way. It's totally different. That's why you cannot be the same as those who have not made Jesus the Lord, their Lord and Savior. You cannot value the same things. Not everything. You cannot value just all the same thing. Some of their values will clash with your values. Not just those who don't know God, but even those who are in the church who have not renewed their mind to the kingdom value, you will have a clash of values. Amen. Because the kingdom is countercultural. Someone says countercultural. In Matthew chapter 6, Jesus was teaching us, Matthew 5 and 6 and 7, he was teaching us about the kingdom culture. And you know the way Jesus will say, will start, turn to Matthew chapter 5. Let me show you something. You see the way Jesus will start when he was talking about the culture of the kingdom. There's a phrase that he constantly repeated there to just tell you that I came to upend the way the world thinks. I came to upend the way it was what? The world thinks. Let's start from verse 21. You see the phrase being repeated. You have heard it. You have heard that it was said. Everybody say, you have heard. That it was what? It was said to the people long ago. Do not murder. And anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. But then Jesus, but I now tell you that anyone who is angry with his brother will be subject to judgment. So he said, you have heard it that it was said. But now I am telling you something different. The kingdom is countercultural. If you go again to verse 27, you will see it again. You have heard it that it was said that you should not commit adultery. But I say to you that anyone who looks on a woman with lustful thoughts has already committed adultery with her in his heart. You see, you have heard that it was said, but I'm telling you something different. Amen. Verse 31. It is also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you. So you go on and on and on and on. You have heard it was said. Verse 20, verse 38. An eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. You know, that was a revenge. But I say to you, do not resist evil. Please take kids that cry out and make them feel very comfortable outside. Amen. Hallelujah. You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for what? For a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist anyone who is evil. But if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the others also. So you see, in the world, revenge. Eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, no. Do it the other way. So you see, the kingdom is countercultural. The values of the kingdom are different from the values of this world. So as a kingdom person, you must be different. Everybody say, I must be different. Say, I must appreciate some things that the world does not celebrate. I must celebrate some values, some attitudes that the world thinks is crazy. Then I'm living the kingdom culture. And then I have an assignment. Say, I have an assignment. To now take that value or those values of the kingdom that I have imbibed to spread it everywhere. Through my lifestyle. Through my message. Everywhere I find myself. Say, that is my kingdom assignment. To live the kingdom culture and to spread the kingdom culture. So that's the first characteristics of the kingdom culture. It is countercultural. Number two, it pleases God. Write it down. It pleases God. When you allow the kingdom culture to become your culture, the culture of your life, the culture of your home, your culture at work, the culture of a church, the culture of a nation, it pleases God. It pleases God. God is pleased because you are now living according to his own country principle. Amen. Number three, it will be rewarded. When you live according to the kingdom culture, it will be rewarded. And Jesus said, the rewards for the kingdom culture is lasting. Everybody say, it is lasting. After he finished teaching us about the culture, in Matthew chapter 7, look at it. Matthew chapter 7. In verse 24, let's read it. Matthew 7, verse 24. Everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. So those who live by the kingdom culture and those who live by the world's culture, they are both building edifices. Amen? They are both building houses. In fact, the one living by the world's culture can build the house faster. Your friends, your mates, who just anything goes, they can make it faster. They can climb at work faster. It can look as if things are better. Amen. But the Bible says that it will not last. Someone say it will not last. Because anything that is, hallelujah, that is not the kingdom of God is not durable. Repeat that after me. Say, everything that is not part of the kingdom of God is not durable. It's not durable. It's only the kingdom of God that is durable. Every other thing is going to pass. Hallelujah. But Hebrews 13 says, but we have received a kingdom that cannot be moved. Amen. Someone say, a kingdom that cannot be moved. So I want to encourage every one of you. Many of us are young. Everyone here is young. Amen. At least compared to Abraham. Now, if you will build your life on the kingdom culture, make it your lifestyle, I can assure you that no matter the storms, the rain, no matter what comes in life, comes against you later, you will be standing. Because the kingdom is durable. When you build your life on mercy, on excellence, on compassion, on honor, hallelujah, you build your life on giving, you build your life on love, joy, peace, self-control. When you build it on the fruit of the Spirit, when you build it on purpose, when you build your life on all these things we're going to be sharing, when you build your life on that, I can assure you that it will last. If you're a business person here, when you build your business on those things, it will last and it will prevail. Amen. When you build your family on those things, it will last and it will prevail. But if you build with wood and air, and you build with those things that don't last. When you build, you're just trying to copy Oprah. I don't have anything against Oprah. Oprah is, I think she's doing better now. Amen. You are building it according to what you hear on the TV. You are building according to what you read in a book. You are building according to all, how the world does it. Those things don't last. Don't build your life like Hollywood. Amen. Don't build your marriage. Don't build those things. You already know how the marriage lasts only. You get married 5 times in 5 years. Amen. It's not durable. Don't make Hollywood your mentor. Hallelujah. Don't make them your mentor. Don't make those movie stars your mentor. Make God's word your mentor. Someone say, make God's word my mentor. It won't last. Don't build your life on the guy in the neighborhood who looks like he has everything, but he's dealing drugs and he's doing all that. You know what happens now? In the next 2 years, he's dead. Or he's locked up in prison forever. Don't build your life on that. It doesn't last. It's not durable. Amen. I like to look at those who have lasted. That's why you see in my, my basement, you see pictures of people. I see Billy Graham. I put him there. I say, these people lasted with no scandal. Let me find out. Let me look at them. And let me find out what they did. Because I want something that will last. Amen. Someone said, I don't want to fall with a crash. Amen. It's one thing to go up. Amen. But it's another thing to stay up. Yes. Things fall with a crash. So some of you might see somebody right now. It's like, he's growing up. Say, wow, I admire that person. Might be your friend, another going up. One thing is to go up. The other thing is to stay up. I'd rather go up gently than to grow up very fast and crash very fast. I'd rather build. according to the kingdom culture. I'm encouraging you all, please build according to the culture of God. Don't build according to man's culture. Don't build according to the world's culture. So God is pleased with it. And then the last one, I already explained it. It makes for true and lasting greatness. When you build according to the kingdom culture, it makes for true. It might not happen very fast, but it makes for true and lasting greatness. It's like the hare and the tortoise. How many of you have heard the story before? The tortoise and the hare. The hare was like leader, running and everything. But the tortoise was just consistency. Someone say consistency. I'd rather be slow and consistent, amen, and build correctly than to be very fast, and then I can't make it to the finish line. Amen. So sometimes the kingdom of God is like that. It is microwaved, not cooked. Sorry, it is cooked, not microwaved. Microwaved, amen. I like microwave when it comes to food, amen. It is cooked, not what? Microwave. It is sometimes very slow. But don't ever be intimidated by slowness. Someone said, don't be intimidated by slowness. Sometimes you should be scared when things are happening too fast. Sometimes. Amen. I know we all like speedy stuff, amen. But be careful. Most accidents happen when you are speeding. Not when you are going slowly. Amen. So don't always go for speedy stuff. Get rich quickly. That's get poor fast. Or get into jail fast. Go slow. I would say go slow. Say go slow. Go slow. Somebody said, Jesus told him, he said, I'd rather you be behind me than for you to run after me. I saw you talking for you to run ahead of me. I'd rather, it's because when you are behind me, you are still seeing me. So slow. I'm going to say slow. The fact that some things are slow or maybe delayed in your life does not mean they are denied. It just means that God is working on you. Take it easy. Someone say, take it easy. Don't look at where other people are and start crying. Take it easy. God has a plan for your life. Just go. Slow and steady. Someone say, slow and steady. It's a kingdom culture. Otherwise, you grow corn today, you will start reaping corn tomorrow. Right? You notice that when you plant something, it takes some time, right? You have to go there and pour the water and, when is this corn going to come up? And then maybe like my kids, you go and dig it up. Say, this thing is not coming up. Amen. And then you put it back. And then you kill it. Amen. That's the way some of us behave. I planted this thing, but it's not coming up. So you dig it out. You look at it and it's covered. It's dead. You know, let it die. Amen. That's why, you see, the kingdom of God is reflected by the principles of the world. And one of them is the seed time and harvest principle. Do not be weary in well-doing, for in due season you will reap, if you faint not. In other words, keep the seed in the ground. As long as it is in the ground, it is safe. Don't pull it out. Just wait. Let the rain of God fall on it. Amen. Weed around it. It's coming out. It's coming out. It's coming out. It's coming out. For so is the kingdom of God. It's like a grain of mustard seed, which when it is sown, it is the smallest of all the herbs of the earth. But when it is sown, it grows up and becomes great. Keep it sown. Keep consistent. Stay with that business. Stay with your integrity. Just keep at it. It's going to grow. Someone say it's going to grow. It makes for true and lasting greatness. The real greatness. Not fame. If I want to be famous today, it's very easy. I just get a match and burn down this building and I stand in front. Amen. And then I'll be famous overnight. Amen. We're not talking about fame. Amen. Anybody can be famous. We're talking about greatness. According to God's definition, lasting greatness comes by practicing the principles of the kingdom of God. Amen. Are you following me? Don't cut corners. Tell anybody, say, don't cut corners. Don't try to overtake anybody. Huh? Don't judge yourself by other people. Judge yourself by Christ. Did you get that? Okay, so let's look at the principle we started looking at last week. We have 20 minutes more. Amen. Let's look at the principle we started looking at. The kingdom culture of excellence. Write it down. Say the kingdom culture of excellence. The kingdom culture of excellence. Daniel chapter 6, verse 3. Daniel 6, verse 3. The kingdom culture of excellence. Daniel chapter 6, verse 3. Daniel 6, 3. Now, Daniel so distinguished himself among the administrators and the satraps by his exceptional qualities that the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. Let's look at it from another translation. Daniel 6, verse 3. Let's look at it from another translation that uses the excellent spirit. I like that excellent spirit. The exceptional qualities, you know it. This one uses great abilities. Good. Then this Daniel distinguished himself above the governors and cetera because what? Everybody repeat it. I say an excellent spirit was in him. I like that. Say after me, say an excellent spirit was in him. So the first thing I want you guys to write down is that excellence is an internal quality, not external. Excellence is what? An internal quality. An excellent spirit was in him. You can't really maintain excellence outside if you are not excellent inside. Excellence is an internal quality. It's a spirit. It's an internal quality. And when it's inside, it will come out. Yes. Amen. It will come out. But we know what it does. Because an excellent spirit was in him, he distinguished himself. So many people want to be distinguished, but they don't want to cultivate the excellent spirit. But the key to being distinguished is to work on yourself to inculcate the kingdom culture of excellence inside yourself. Someone say the kingdom culture of excellence. Did you get it? Yes. To cultivate the excellence spirit. You'll be distinguished everywhere. When you have that excellence spirit within you, you will be distinguished for God's glory. When you cultivate the excellence spirit. Man. So what is excellence? Many people think excellence is trying to beat other people. In fact, if you check the dictionary, I went through the dictionary looking for the definition of excellence. It was always about beating other people. But the biblical definition of excellence is not trying to be better than other people. The biblical definition of excellence means being the best you can be. Everybody write that. Say, being the best that I can be. That's the biblical definition of excellence. Being the best that you can be. It is not comparing yourself with other people. It is being the best that you can be. Huh? The best that you can be. It is matching your practice with your potential. Matching your practice with your potential. We all have potential for things. Now match your practice with it. Being the best that you can be. Excellence is being better tomorrow than you were yesterday. Notice that this has nothing to do with other people, right? It only has to do with you. Excellence is being better tomorrow than you were yesterday. Excellence is beating yourself. Someone say beating myself. You know, when I say beating, I mean you. It's like you are competing with yourself and you are beating yourself. Amen? That's what excellence is. So an excellent person... An excellent person does not want to remain the way he is today, the same way tomorrow. An excellent person is always looking for improvement. Improvement. So let me, for the few minutes we have, let me give you 7 characteristics of the spirit of excellence. 7 characteristics of the spirit of excellence. When somebody is walking the excellence way, what are some things you will notice? What are some attitudes that you imbibe that shows that you are operating by the spirit of excellence? Right, number one, doing your best in everything. Write it down. Number one, characteristics of the spirit of excellence, doing your best in what? Everything. In everything. Doing your best in everything. In Matthew 23, verse 34, and 38, Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your Matthew 23:37. Love the Lord your God with what? All your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. 22:37. This is the first and what? And greatest commandment. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with everything that you've got. You know what? Give God your best in everything. Give God all. I mean, give God what? Your best. Now, let me say this to you. How will you put your best into everything? Look up, everyone. Look at me. How will you get to a point where whatever you are doing, doesn't matter who is looking at you, who is saying thank you, or who is not saying thank you. How will you get to the point where you just have the attitude that, okay, this thing is committed into my hand, I got to give it my best. Whether it's at home, whether it's at work, it's at school, it's at church, this thing, I'm going to give it my all. I'm going to give it my best. How will you get there? The key for me that did it for me was 1 Corinthians 10:31. 1 Corinthians 10:31. This scripture rolls in my mind. When I'm doing anything, I'm preaching right now, it's there, it's behind it. Why do you put your best? 1 Corinthians 10:1. Paul said, therefore, whether you eat or you drink. 31, please. 31, you got it right the first time. Whether you eat or you drink, whatever you do, do it all to what? Some of you that have worked with me, you see that sometimes I get agitated, you know. I mean, when I say agitated, like we're doing something and somebody's trying to cut corners. And I say, no, we're not doing that. Sometimes, maybe I see trash on the floor, like church and all that. You see, I came here yesterday night picking up trash. I came this morning, I saw something, you know. It's something inside of me that says that God deserves the best. Yeah. Yes. God deserves the best. If you can't do that, you know, we can't do that in other places. God deserves the best. So sometimes, you know, you push, you give him the best, because everything you do must be done to the glory of God. Yeah. Someone say, to the glory of God. When you are doing things, don't do it as if you are doing it to a man. Yeah. Men can get anything, but God deserves the best. Yeah. God deserves the best. That's something. When I would rather go late to a party than go late to church. Wow. Amen. Do you get it? I can go late for a party or a game than go late to church, because God deserves the best. But there are some people who go late to work, so who go early to work, go early to parties, but they come late to church. God deserves the best. Someone say, God deserves the best. God deserves the best of my time. So when I'm doing something, whether I'm reading or whether I am, you know, whatever it is I am doing, I'm thinking, I must do this to God's glory. And God is a God of excellence. So we must do it. We must give God our best. Amen. So be your best. Look at anyone, say, be your best. When I'm doing my assignment, you know I'm a student. When I'm doing my assignment for school, I could do it in a sloppy way. But every time I'm doing that assignment, I'm saying, nobody might see me or whatever. I'm doing this, I'm submitting, but I must do my best, because I'm doing it for God's glory. Amen. I'm doing it for God's glory. Whatever it is you are doing, put your best into it. Put your best into it. Turn to your neighbor and say, put your best into it. Let it be known that City Life people are the model employees. Amen. At work. Our home is the model home. Amen. Why? Because we are the Bible that other people will read. Isn't that true? Some people will never come to church. It is you that they are going to see. Some people will never read the Bible. It's you that they are going to see. And the way you live is the Bible that is preaching. It's preaching to them. So make up your mind to put your best in everything. At work, don't do sloppy things for your bosses. Amen. Put your best into it. That's the spirit of excellence. Hallelujah. You know, let me give you this reasoning. Listen to this. Talking about doing things to the Lord. If you have that consciousness in your mind that what I'm doing is for the Lord, is to the Lord, is for the Lord, is to the Lord. Think about it. Let me ask you this question. If you had an appointment with the Lord, will you show up? Let's say Jesus Christ appears now and says, let's meet at 10. And you say, I'll be there by 10. Will you show up? Will you? Because you are doing it to the Lord. Now, will you show up late? When will you? We show up early, right? But if something happened and you are not able to make it, what will you do? You will call Jesus, right? And say, Jesus, I'm sorry. You're going to perform a miracle. I'm late. Isn't that what you would do? Right? So the same thing, when you set appointments with people, when you set appointments, when you have scheduled things that you've agreed to, do that at all times. Don't just stay away and don't just stay late. Amen. Be responsible because you are meeting with Jesus. Amen. Last scripture, Ecclesiastes 9:10, for the first one, Ecclesiastes 9:10. Let's read it together, everybody. 1, 2, let's go. Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 10. Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with what? With all your might. After this service right now, we're going to get behind this place. We've already broken down the path. We're going to be breaking down some other things in the preparation for the stage you want to build and all the other stuff. It doesn't matter if anybody sees you or anybody doesn't see you. You do it with all your might. Amen. Yes. Because you are doing it to what?
Lord.
You are doing it to the Lord. Amen. You're doing it to the Lord. Number 2, I got to rush. The spirit of excellence does more than it has to. The spirit of excellence always does more than it has to. The spirit of excellence goes beyond the call of duty. When somebody is operating by the spirit of excellence, he does more than he has to. He or she does more than he has to do. Always goes beyond the call of duty. You don't do below it. You don't just say, okay, I've done what I need to do. Let's go. No, you go beyond. Someone say, you go beyond. You go beyond. You go beyond. Matthew chapter 5, verse 41. Jesus said, if anybody asks you to go a mile, go with him what? 2 miles. If people ask you to go a mile, go with you what? Go with him what? 2 miles. Some people, they ask you ask to go 1 mile, you go below 1 mile. Or you ask to go 1 mile, you go 1 mile and say, I'm done. No. When people ask you to go 1 mile, Jesus said, go 2 miles. Always go beyond the call of duty. Always do beyond yourself. At work, everywhere, always do. Let people say, wow, this person does more. Those are the people that are honored. Those are because you are honoring God. Excellent people always do more. They don't just do what is adequate. That is mediocrity. You do more. They give you an assignment at school. You color it. You put something on it. You bind it. You do all that. They say, wow, that's even more than what we asked for. Amen. Yes. Do more. That's the excellent spirit. Do more. 1 Thessalonians 4:1. Brethren, we request and exhort you in the Lord Jesus Christ as you have received from us an instruction how you ought to walk to please God, that you may excel still more. In other words, you were doing it, but now, you know, you excel still more. You are bound more and more. You excel still more. In other words, you've done it. Do more. Amen. Someone say, do more. That's number 3. Number 3. The scripture I gave you, number 3. Constant and never-ending improvement. Number 3. Characteristics of somebody with the spirit of excellence. The person undergoes constant and never-ending improvements. They don't get satisfied with the, you know, what they did last year or last week or yesterday. They're always looking for, how can I better myself? They're always looking for improvement. They're always evaluating themselves. Amen. They're evaluating this. Can I do better? Can I do better? The excellent spirit always wants to do better. Always wants to do better. And we have so many scriptures on it. Write it down. 2 Corinthians. I don't have the time. 2 Corinthians 8:7. He said, but that you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge. 2 Corinthians 8:7. As you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, and in all eagerness, and in the love from us that is in you, make sure you excel in this kindness also, in this grace also. You know what? You might excel in one area, but always look for another area that you can excel. Amen. Someone say, constant and never unending improvement. 1 Thessalonians 4:10. For indeed, you practice love all towards the brethren who are in Macedonia, but we urge you, brethren, to still excel more, to still abound more. Always try to beat yourself. Always try to improve yourself. Get a mentor. Go to school. Learn the skill. Don't sit down with your skill level and be struggling with it. Find somebody with a better skill level. Improve it. People who are excellent are always seeking for improvement. They're always asking, how can I do better? What is missing? Well, how can I do better? That's the spirit of excellence. Number 4, take care of what God has given you. The spirit of excellence takes care of what God has given you already. Take care of what God has given you. Amen. Excellence is not about spending money. Excellence is not about expensive or extravagance. Some people confuse it. That's not excellence. For example, when we're coming from New Orleans, we were in New Orleans this week, and we're coming back, Pastor Omo, Pastor Lumide, and I, we stop at my friend's church, Pastor Sino, that'll be preaching. When I got into the church, wow, I got into his office. I felt like sleeping there. I didn't want to come back to Chicago. Amen. Pastor Omo felt that, like, what is this? Okay, we saw the church building and everything. Wow, this is beautiful. And I just thank God for him and everything. But when we're coming back, when we're coming, and I got to this place, I got excited when I saw this building. You know what God spoke to me? He said, excellence is not you asking for the bigger thing. Excellence is you using what you have to the best. In other words, how do you know you are excellent? It is when you take your one-room apartment and make it a palace. You get it. It's not getting a big house. Make your one room apartment what? A palace. Amen. Excellence is making your car a cozy place that people want to just lie down there. Amen. Even though when you are driving it, it is making sounds. Amen. That's excellence. Excellence is shining your one shoe. Amen. That people can see their faces on it when they look. They don't need mirrors. Amen. That's excellence. It's not getting more. It's using what you have to the best. Amen. Yeah, that's excellence. It's not money. It's not big. It's not shiny. You know, man, there are some excellent people that have only one suit. Amen. They have only one jeans. But when they hang on that jeans, hey, when they come out with the jeans, you will know that there's something about this person. It's not about what you have. It's what you do with what you have. Amen. Excellence is not having the best job. It's doing the best thing with the job you have. Amen. Excellence is not about, my wife needs to change. It's enjoying the best with the wife that you have. Amen. Doing the best with the wife. Doing the best with the husband you have. Amen. Let's thank God for what we have and do the best with what we have. That is the spirit of excellence. Number 5. I will get to 7. I'll stop. Excellence is doing the right things. Not because someone is watching you, but because it is right. Yeah. Excellence is doing the right things. Not because someone is watching you, but just because it is right. The person with an excellent spirit does what is right, even when no one is what? Watching. Sometimes you are taking your thing. I'm taking my socks and all that. And then in the night, I'm just so tired. And I just take off everything. I just try to put it somewhere in my closet. And something just tells me, nobody sees you. But is this excellent? Amen. Nobody's going to evaluate me. Amen. But then you just take it, put it, and put it in the right places that it's supposed to be. Nobody has to see you. Excellence is what? Doing the right things because it is right. Just because it is right. Amen. That's what Joseph had. Nobody could see him with Potiphar's wife, but it was just the right thing. That's what Daniel had. Amen. Just doing the right thing, even though nobody sees you. That is the excellent spirit. You know, anybody can do anything outside. But when it's you let that still small voice tell you, oh, No. Nobody is seeing you with this thing, but it's just not just the right thing to do. Amen. Like I told you, God is excellent even in secret. There are many places that nobody will even be on the earth, but you see beautiful flowers and all those things there. Nobody might set their eyes on them, but God still does excellent things, even when it is secret. Amen. So excellence is not about what people can see. It's not about the part of your house that everybody comes to, but the part that nobody comes to. Amen. That's when you know whether you have an excellent spirit. Hallelujah. Number six, excellence is doing little things right. Excellence is what? Everybody say doing little things. Right. Doing little things. What? Right. Little things. You know, play it right. You know, do it. Little things. Things that don't matter. Picking up. You are going, you get to the restroom or you go outside and you see a piece of paper on the ground. That piece of paper is not supposed to be there. You pick it up and you put it in the trash can. That is the excellent. Come on, that's the excellent spirit. Doing little things. The diaper that your kids uses, it is you packing it very well. You're going to put it where? In the right place where it's not going to smell and disturb other people. Amen. Excellence is doing little things right. Amen. Closing the door when you need to close the door. Amen. Did you get that? Someone said doing little things right. You see, those who have the excellence, they are conscious of little things. They don't just say, oh, that's just little. No. They are conscious of what? Of little things. Arranging things neatly. Someone said neatly. Straight. Just straightening things up and all that. It's the spirit of excellence. I want us to imbibe it. Someone said, I need to imbibe it. You will know how important it is to do little things right. Can you imagine if your pilot does not do little things right? And you are in the plane. Amen. Just one little tiny thing. The pilot does not do it right. Kills everybody. Because he's supposed to calibrate one thing. Say, that doesn't matter. Put the autopilot for landing. Let the wheel come out. No, we can land without the wheel. See, that's an exaggeration. But it is part of the training for being a pilot. What about you doctors? Can you imagine your doctor opening you up and forgotten the scissors in there? Like just a scissors, it will pass it out, you know. Oh, no, scissors is too big. A safety pin. Huh? Just forget a safety pin in there. You say, that's fine. It's just safety pin. Don't come out. You see how important little things are? You see how important little things are? Do you get it? Your own might not be life-threatening, but it still matter. Little things still matter. Amen. Little things still matter. Let's take little things. Song of Solomon, chapter 2. Look at it. Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 15. Solomon, giving wisdom, he said, take away the little foxes. Someone say little foxes. He said, catch for us. Everybody say, catch for us. The little foxes. The little foxes that ruin the what? The vineyards. Our vineyards that are in bloom. It is those little foxes that ruin those things. Some people right now, it is just some little attitudes, some little things that is holding them down. Amen. It is those forces. You pray, you fast, you do other, but it's those little things. Loving your wife, loving your husband, you know, practicing excellence, ordering your life, having a schedule, keeping your appointment, keeping your word, saying I'm sorry. You know, it is those things, arriving early, just little things. It is what is stopping your life. It is not those big things. The forces are there, but the forces against you, they are those tiny things. He said, take away those little foxes so that it can bloom. Amen. Sometimes it's little things holding us down. Little hinges swing great doors. Excellence does little things right. And finally, number seven. Excellence does not compromise or go with the flow, even though it is popular. The person with the excellent spirit does not compromise or go with the flow, even though it is popular. You know, sometimes you are trying to do something, and people say, you know what, Pastor? Isn't it easier for you to do this way? God has not called us to do easy things. He has called us to do right things. Amen. He has called us to do right things, not easy things. You know, sometimes when we're breaking down this building, breaking it down, sometimes we will break down a wall or whatever, and we will see, juice boxes and we see trash, even weevil saw, you know, something that looks so, but Fred, you remember? Something hanging, and like, what is this one? You know, you see it inside all the walls. I'm like, who are the people that built this thing? Who was in their head? Why would you hide the juice boxes you are drinking and the bottles, put it there, and then drywall it? What kind of a thinking is that? What kind of a thinking is that? It's that kind of thinking. Just hide, put it under the, you know, as long as we are covering it up, nobody's going to see it. That's not excellence. Excellence, even though nobody's going to enter the drywall, you arrange the wire straight, amen. You do everything straight, even though nobody's going to see it, just because it's the right thing to do. Just because it's the right thing to do. That is what built a great nation like this. People paying attention to little things, and it came from the kingdom. But go to those nations when nobody cares about little things. You see trash overflowing. You see, because everybody just don't care about little things. Excellence is doing little things right. Doing little things right. Don't compromise or go with the flow. I tell my children, remember Jesse and Joshua? I said, do the hard things. Do the hard things. Don't do easy things in life. Do the hard things. Because when you do easy things, you become like a river that meanders. Your life is like a snake. But when you do the hard things, you can go forward. Do the hard things in life. Don't do the easy things. Don't do what all your friends are doing. Don't do drugs. Don't do all those things. That's easy. It's easy to get into drugs, to get into gangs and do all that. But it is hard to live right and become an example. Amen. You do the hard thing. Last scripture, Daniel 1, verse 7. Excellence is not going with the flow. Daniel 1, 7. Said the chief of the officials gave them new names. Daniel, the name Belteshazzar, Shadrach to Azariah, Meshach, and to Azariah Abednego. But verse 8, everybody, let's read verse 8 together. Let's stand up and read it together, everyone. Daniel chapter 1, verse 8. 1, 2, let's go. But resolve not to defile himself with the royal food and wine. And he asked for the chief official for permission not to defile himself in this way. Look at it. Nobody will have criticized Daniel for doing it. Right? I mean, meat and wine. Just eat it, drink it. That's it. That's what everybody was doing, right? All the other people were doing exactly the same thing. Nobody will criticize him for doing it. He could have just done it, right? But in fact, it was mandated that they do it. Wow. Can you imagine if they make a law right now that say every one of you have to eat meat? And then you now say, please give me permission not to eat meat. Or maybe there's a law that comes right now. They make a law in Chicago or the United States. I say, everybody now, you have to do this. The normal thing is just to do what everybody's saying. That's what everybody believes right now. But this guy was convinced of something, that this is different from the values. And he says, you know what? I'm going to abstain. I'm going to ask for permission not to do this. I will not go with the flow. Excellent people with the excellence, we don't go with the flow. They don't go with the flow. So everybody is doing that. People are bribing. People are stealing money. People are lying. People are cutting corners. People are doing all that. But you know what? I know it's easy to do that. It's easy to just flow with the crowd. People are getting into drugs. They're getting into gangs. They're doing all that. I know it's easy to do that. People are leaving their wives. They are leaving their husband. They are cheating on their wives and cheating on their husband. They're doing everything. I know that's easy to do. But I will do the hard thing. Amen. I will do the half. Someone say, I will do the half thing. Say, I resolve not to defile myself with the royal food and wine. And you know what? You know God honored him? God honored him. He said, verse 9, that even though he didn't go the way that everybody was going, let's look at verse 9. He said, now God had caused the official to show favor and sympathy to Daniel. Excellence brings favor. Someone say, excellence brings favor. And he said, you know what? If you do this thing, you look worse than all your mates. How can you say you're not going to do what everybody's doing? You will never get married. This is somebody that loved him, that he had favor with advising him. You're not going to get married. You are not you. That business is not going anywhere. And you are saying your business is God-based. You better remove God from it if you want it to prosper. No, don't put God in there. It won't go anywhere. You will never. It was loving people giving him advice. You know what? Even if you don't do it now, the king will even kill me. But look at what happened to Daniel. Let's read it. Daniel said to the guard, whom the chief officer had appointed over Daniel. Verse 12. Please test your servants for 10 days. Give us nothing but vegetables to eat and water to drink. Verse. Then compare our appearance with that of the young men who eat the royal food and treat your servant in accordance with what you see. So he agreed with this and tested them for 10 days. Everybody read this together. 1, 2, let's go. He looked healthier. That thing that you're trying to compromise, to try to just go with the flow, if you would just stay with God's values, amen? If you would just stick with God's values, when people evaluate later, you will discover that you are healthier, you are fatter, because you have chosen the more resilient and the more durable way. Amen. You will always turn out better when you choose the culture of God. Did you get something today? You got it? Lift your hands and tell God whatever you want to tell him about it. Just pray to God about what you've heard today. Make the commitment you want to make. Make a commitment you want to make. The word of God is living and active. And it is sharper than any two-edged sword. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It presses even to the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirit, the bone and the marrow. And it's a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, so that the man of God might be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. God's word comes so that we can be better. So Lord, I receive your word today. Come on, pray. I receive your word today. If you are here today and you have not made Jesus the Lord of your life, or you have left Jesus, you have left Jesus. I want you to lift your hands and pray right now and ask Jesus to come into your heart. Ask him to come into your heart. Yes, ask him to come into your heart. Say, Jesus, come into my heart. I come back to you. He will save you. Lift your hands and pray. Say, Lord, come into my heart. Jesus, I receive you. Receive me again. I come back to you. I've gone through the easy path, but now I've chosen you, O Lord. I've chosen you, O Lord. I've chosen you, O Lord. Come into my heart. Come and be my Lord and my Savior. I choose the way of excellence. I choose the way of Christ. Oh, in the name of everybody, pray this prayer, including those who are praying to get saved. Lift your hand if you're praying. You want to come back to Jesus or receive. Lift your hand and everybody, let's pray together. Say, dear Lord Jesus, I thank you for your word today. I receive it. I believe that you are an excellent God. And I want that excellent spirit to be expressed in my life. I resolve, like Daniel, to live the excellent life. I will choose you. Lord Jesus, come and live in my heart. You are the excellent one. Come and live through me. Help me to love God with all that I have. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Make me your child. Thank you, Lord, for I will live your values. I will spread your excellence, and your name will be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah. Let's give God a big clap. Amen. Please, you may be seated very briefly. At this time, we want to quickly acknowledge those that are visiting or worshiping with us for the first time. We're not going to keep you or delay you. If this is your first time at City Light, please just raise up your hand. We want to welcome you with a gift. Let's put our hands together for them. Please keep your hand up just real briefly so that we can identify you and give you your welcome package. Hallelujah. You're very welcome to City Light. We really appreciate you coming to visit with us. And if anytime you're in the neighborhood, please feel free to join us. There's always a warm seat of welcome for you here. And, you know, if you do not have a church home, very much would like for you to be a part of what we're doing here at City Light. God bless you and welcome once again. Please, can we just rise up to our feet as we end the service? Remember, there's a demolition work going on after the service for the guys. Yes, so there's some demolition work, like I said, after the service. So for the guys, if you're available, we'd like to ask for you to join us as we continue what we're doing with the demolition work. Can you touch hands with your neighbor? And repeat after me. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you, Lord, for this day. This is a day you've made, and I'm excited about this day. I rejoice in all the wonderful things you're doing and that you have done. Father, I thank you for an excellent spirit. I walk in an excellent spirit this week. Father, may your will be done in my life. Your kingdom come in my life in this week. In the name of Jesus, we give you praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name. And as I go this week, help me to shine as a light to my world, a light to my family, a light to my community. I will walk in your wisdom, in your power, and in your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God.
Hallelujah. So we're just going to declare that we're walking by faith as we're going into our week this week, in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.